Good morning and happy Sunday. Welcome to Friendship House of Prayer. I am Pastor C, and this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Listen, we come with a great praise report today that Sister Linda Crutcher is out of the hospital. I spoke with her yesterday, and she wants to thank everyone for your prayers, for your calls, for your cards, and everything. She wants to thank you all. So we thank and praise God for that she is on her way of healing and is doing well. Also, we have another praise report. I told you last week that we had 5 people join Friendship House of Prayer. So we are thankful and praising God just for that. And you all know Sister Peggy White's, her daughters, Sister Karen White and Sister Christy Grace. And also their children, Amari Thomas, Jalen Grace, and Natalie Grace. So we thank and praise God for them coming on board and doing the work of the Lord. They're no stranger to our ministry because they all been still attending church and services and still working in the ministry. So we thank and praise God for them. Amen. God is just so great. And also, we want to talk today about, will you stand or will you bow? This message today just penetrated my heart in such a way because I took it more personal. Will you stand or will you bow? It's going to be coming from the book of Daniel. I'm going to read it for you. The book of Daniel, chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. The book of Daniel, chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. It reads, "Then Nebuchadnezzar flew into a rage and ordered that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be brought to him. When they were brought in, Nebuchadnezzar said to them, 'Is this true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you refuse to serve my God or to worship the gold statue that I have set up? I will give you one more chance to bow down and worship the statue that I have made when you hear the sound of the music instruments. But if you refuse, you will be thrown immediately into the blazing furnace. And then what God will be able to serve you from my power?' Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied, 'O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to save us. He will rescue us from your power, your majesty. But even if,'" this is verse 18, this is it right here, "'but even if he doesn't, we want to make it clear to you, your majesty, that we would never serve your gods or worship the gold statue you have set up.'" We would never. They said, "even if." It's our message today. We want to talk about, will you stand or will you bow? Let us go into a word of prayer and then go into a praise and worship. Amen. Gracious God, we come right now in the name of Jesus. Lord God, we come thanking you for another day. We thank you, God, for life, for health, for strength today. We thank you just for being a great God. We thank you, oh God, for breathing the breath of life on us today. And Lord God, we thank and praise you just for the simple things this morning. We thank you for the sun. We thank you for the moon. We thank you for the rain. We thank you for your son, the S-O-N, that came and died, bled, and hung for us, oh God. We give you praise today because you are worthy to be praised. Father God, I ask right now at this time that you remove self out the way, Lord God, so you can stand up in me, Lord God, and have your way, Father God, that the word will penetrate the heart to bring about a change. Oh God, we thank you. We praise you. We adore you. We magnify you. We shabbat you, oh God, on today. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen and amen. Let's go into praise and worship.
You gave me my hands. How do you, would you say to use me, Lord, to show someone the way and enable me to say,
you stand or will you bow? That is the question today. Will you stand or will you bow? Today, we're just going to pull out a portion of this story because in this particular text, it's tailored to teach us not to compromise our principles, not to compromise our integrity, not to compromise the promises of God that we stand on today. You know, when the heat is on and the fire is burning in the furnace and you are being threatened to get thrown in there, not to compromise your principles and the promises that you're standing on, not to go against God. When your back is against the wall, and sometimes in life, it happens. Your back is against the wall. We want to stand firm on our principles. We want to stand firm on the promises that God has made to us because his word doesn't come back void to him. We want to stand on that. Here, King Nebuchadnezzar was the supreme ruler of Babylon. So whatever he said, that was it. And he expected totally obedience. Once he said something, that was it, or you can be killed. So here it was, his pride had caused him to go beyond his own authority. He took it way to the highest of heights. He didn't care. He built this statue, this gold statue that stood 90 feet high and 9 feet wide. This statue was of himself. It was an image of himself. It's supposed to have been a wall, but he made this image of himself. And usually with the statues like that, sometimes they have a gold head. With this king, he had the whole thing gold. From head to toe, the whole statue was gold from head to toe. All of it was just gold. He didn't care. It was what he said. That was it. He tried to come and threaten people. He had his leadership come in. And so they had this ceremony for this statue. So he had all of them to bow down and worship this statue. And so what he did it in a way to bring all of them in to like call a corporate form of worship. And really, he tried to solidify his power, saying, because he was in power, because I am the king, what I say go. You know, sometimes we work on jobs and we have bosses like that. I am the boss. What I say goes, and everything like that. If you have to constantly say who you are, you are really questioning who you are on the inside. Even in church, it spills to the church who you are as far as your position, as far as what title you hold. I am this. I hold this position. I'm this. If you have to constantly remind people of who you are, something's going on the inside of the fact that you're not sure who you are. More importantly, whose you are. Because the God in us, just because of our walk, should allow people to see whose we are and what we stand for. So this king was intimidating everyone because he was king. He was the ruler. He was the man. He formed a decree that if you did not bow, you would be thrown into this fiery furnace. He said that every time you hear the band, the musicians play, whatever you're doing, I don't care where you are or whatever you're doing, stop and bow down and start to worship this statue. So he said, whenever you hear the music, wherever you are, stop doing what you're doing and bow down and start worshiping this statue, which is the image of himself. This gold statue that stood so tall and was so wide, bow down and worship this statue. When he had the leadership there, he had the governor, he had the princes, he had the counselors, he had the judges, he had everybody there. So he figured if he can get the leadership to go ahead and bow down, then he'll easily get the people to go ahead and bow down. That's why this walk with Christ, you have to stand alone. You have to stand for yourself. Even though the majority may rule, that does not mean the majority is right. That's why you have to stand and know the word of God for yourself, because you don't want to be geared in the wrong direction. So know the word, study the word, study to show thyself approved. Study the word for yourself. It can be little scripture by little scripture, small chapters by small chapters. Learn and just start to just eat and digest the word so you will know it for yourself. That is your defense right there. So when things come against you, you have the power to reject it so it can flee. But if we're not reading, it does us no good. We just have the word of God. So this king, he had this in place. So he had this gold statue that he was just so proud of. He was just so excited about it. He had everybody bowing to it. It made him feel like he was somebody. And when people like that, you notice they have such huge insecurities on the inside. When I have to promote myself of who I am, and I am the boss of you, and what you do is predicated on what I say, we have to start rethinking who we're listening to. Is it man or is it God? Will we bow down to statues or will we stand on the promises of God? We have to make that decision because God is a jealous God. This statue just didn't represent just a statue. It was a form of idolatry. So this form, this statue, it was more than just bowing down. When they're bowing down, they're putting their faith in the statue versus putting their faith in God. They're saying, God, this statue, you are our God. We claim you as our God. We bow to you. We worship you. We adore you. This is a statue. A statue. Not the living God. This is a statue. So here, he's making this decree that if you don't do it, you will be thrown into this fiery furnace. And this fiery furnace was so hot, if you stand on the outside, you will burn up and die. It wasn't just a regular heat. They cranked it up and turned it up. So if you didn't bow and do what he said do, then you would die. So what would you do in situations like that? I know for God I live, for God I die. It's easy to say that now. And that's what we hope that we would do. Because when you get into a certain place or a certain space or a certain situation, things seem to be changed. So when you don't have a lot to lose, you can easily go ahead and say, well, I'm just going to lose a lot. So I'll go ahead and do what needs to be done. But when you have a whole lot to lose, Jesus the Christ, you have to start rethinking what you're going to do. Weigh your options. I would stand for Christ and not bow for man, not bow for no statue. What can a statue? A statue can't bring you healing. A statue cannot bring you deliverance. A statue cannot save you. Only God can. So here come these three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He said, you're going to have to bow when all the music is playing. When the band is playing, I need you to bow down and worship. So when the music started to play, they didn't bow down. So others saw them and told the king, make mention, these three Hebrew boys, they didn't bow down when the music and when the band played. So it's a disrespect to you, king. They don't care. They're not worshiping you. They're not bowing down to you. The king immediately got upset, got mad. He was full of rage. He ordered Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, bring them to me. I want to see them. I want to understand why they're not bowing down. See, it is very imperative. It is vital, people of God, that we keep our face in the face of God. We have to, for his direction. He will order our steps in the way we should go. So here they come, these three Hebrew boys coming to the king as he ordered them to. He says, understand that you did not bow when the music was playing. That is my decree. That is my order. That is my commandment. He said, listen here. I'm going to give you one more chance. I'm going to give you one more chance. So I'm going to send you back. And when you hear that music, when you hear the band playing, you are to bow down and worship that gold, beautiful statue, the image of me. You are to worship. The Hebrew boys, they looked at him. He says, no need. We don't need to defend ourselves regarding anything because we will not bow. Because the God we serve, hallelujah, the God we serve is able to save us. King says, okay, if you think your God can save you from the hands of my power, you will be in the fiery furnace. You will be dead. You will be gone. The Hebrew boys, they didn't bow. They didn't break or bow down to the king. They didn't break and bow down to this statue that they were ordered to worship. They stood firm on the promises of God and said they would not bow, but instead they would stand for Christ, because for God they live and for God they die. He said this in verse 18, if God don't do it, it's not because he couldn't do it, but because it is his will at that time that he decided not to do it. That's the thing right there. We have to stand on the promises of God. Verse 18 just cleared it out for me. But even if he doesn't, the Bible says, we want you to know. He said, I want you, the voice, and I want you to be very clear on this, that we will not bow, point blank, period. We will not bow to your gold statues. He said, even if we go back out, we'd rather go in the fiery furnace. And so you say we would die. But we know and we trust in God that our God will save us. Our God have our back. Our God will wrap his loving arms around us and keep us safe. He said, so no matter what, even if God decides not to do it because it's not in his will at this time, it doesn't matter, because rather yay or nay, we will not bow to your statue, your gold statue that stands 90 feet tall and 9 feet wide. We will not bow. We will stand on the promises of God. See, this went beyond just bowing down. They're talking about you went against God when you said what God gonna say to you. The Hebrew boys look, Meshach, they looked and they said, hold on, wait a minute. You talking about our God? Man, this is our God is a God of power. This is the powerful of God. We're talking about the ability of God, the dunamis of God. We're talking about this is the God of all power. You can't touch that. Certainly, we are going to stand, hallelujah, on the promises of God. My question to you today is, what gold statue that stands 90 feet tall and 9 feet wide that's pulling at your spirit, that's asking you to bow? Is it money? Is it that man? Is it that woman? Is it these material things? Is it a house or car? What is pulling at you that will cause you to compromise your principle, to compromise your integrity, to have you to bow and worship idols instead of standing on the promises of God? We have to get it right, people of God. We have to get it right. We have to start trusting God through the bad times. We have to start trusting God when it seems dark and dim. We have to start trusting God. Because I know sometimes it seems so dim and dark. Sometimes you just can't see. But you can see in the dark. Because God will provide that light. He will provide that way because he is the light of the world. We can't see through dark times only if we're standing on the promises of God. We can see during that time, but you have to stand on God's promises. The enemy comes to throw you off. He wants you gone. He wants you to bow down. He wants to look at God and say, ha ha. Look at your son. Look at your daughter. They're bowing down to me because I'm their God. Now, we have to stand on the promises of God. If we don't stand for something, you know it. We'll fall not for anything, but for everything. If we don't stand on the promises of God, will you stand or will you bow? I hope your answer is you will stand. That you will stand so tall that God will just pat you on your back and let you know that you are on the right track. That you will stand so tall for God, the others around you will see the God in you. And they will be coming running. What must I do to be saved? I want to serve a God like you. We serve the one and only true God that sent his son, Jesus the Christ, to die for us and rose with all power. I pray that you receive something from this message, that your choice today will be to stand and not bow. If it's you that don't know God and the pardon of your sins, you can know God. And you can make him Lord of your life. You tell the Lord, Lord, I am a sinner. And I'm asking you, Lord, to forgive me for all my sins that I have done. I'm asking, Lord, that you come into my heart. And I want to make you Lord of my life. Lord, I love you. And I believe that you are God with all power in your hand. I believe you died and rose again with all power. Lord, come into my heart and be the Lord of my life. And the Bible declares that you shall be saved. I pray that you have a saving spirit today, that you will make Lord the King, the number one of your life. I thank and praise God for you. I thank and praise God for everything that he is doing at Friendship House of Prayer. Through this pandemic, God is still good. We still serve a good God because he is still sovereign. And we want to remember to call people, love on people, pick up that phone, and start speaking greatness in people's lives. Tell them how much you love them and give them some hope. Give them your testimony because people are won over by your testimony. I know that you have been through some things in your life. That some that God will give permission for you to tell it and to help somebody. Because we not all have been saved and living this holy, holy life. But we have slipped up. We have messed up. And because of God's grace, thank you, Jesus. Because of his grace, we are still here. Because of his mercy and his grace, we are still covered by the blood of God. Because of his grace, had it not been for Jesus Christ, where would we be? Thank you. God, take us not to things, but God, take us through things. Because when we go on to things, that's our destination. But when we go on through things, we see something on the other end that's greater. That God says, I have something for you. I need you to go through these chapters. I need you to come through. Don't stop. Just keep going through. Walk through the fire. Walk through the storm. And know that you are covered because destiny is on the other end. May God continue to bless you, keep you, and keep your mind stayed on him. Don't forget to pick up that phone, call people and encourage them, and call people that you don't normally call. Start building a relationship, not only with people, but especially build your relationship with Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, God bless you.
Put your hands together. Let's give Jesus the praise.